Hi and welcome to Shots TV Midweek Extra, and we are back again with episode 11. What's on the show tonight? Well, first of all, I catch up with Stuart Udall. He's a friend of mine and I could have spoke to him for a lot longer than the interview. Hopefully you enjoy it. We tell some stories about what we used to get up to, and also he tells us his path in his football career. We got the normal episodes of Around the World with Matt and Henry. I wonder where they're going to take us today and who they're going to be interviewing. And of course, we'll have Mike here doing the In With A Shot. We also had a quiz last week, and we're going to bring you some highlights of that. And the reason that is it was really, really good fun. And if you were wondering what it was like, you can see some excerpts of that. And obviously, we'll be looking at you to sign up maybe for another one in the future. So that would be really good. No questions this week. We've exhausted your questions to Danny and Shahid for the moment. So that will come back, I'm sure, next week. And in next week's episode, there is a special question and answer session where I'll be interviewing some directors, and we're encouraging you guys to interview directors as well. But what we will do to replace that, there'll be just a little news item with me. I'll just be giving you a little update on what's going around the club. It'll only take a few minutes. So without any further ado, let's get on with the Stuart Udall interview. It's great fun.
Okay, brilliant. I'm delighted to have my old mate, and he is an old mate, Stuart Udall, with me now. Stuart, we're just we haven't seen each other for a while now, and it's been too long. So it's great to catch up with you. But we've been doing these Thursday shows, Stu, and it's just about engagement with all the Shot fans. And every player or every person's got a story to tell. And tonight we'd like to just hear a little bit about your story. You were part of the famous 92 or class of 92, which really was an amazing season. But let's start at the beginning. What was your sort of story about how you got involved with Aldershot, Stuart?
I was there as a kid when Len Walker was manager down at Aldershot. And it was Gillard who was his assistant, I think it was. We had the School of Excellence on the Thursday night, I think, down at the Army camps. So that was sort of the first touch on Aldershot when I was a kid. And then it was Ian McDonald got integrated into that sort of along the way, from player to management. And then he saw me locally, and I think I might have even just been playing locally down Ash or something like that. And he said, "We're restarting next year. Do you fancy coming for a trial?" But I think it might have even been late, actually, because by the time the trials come around and he spoke to me, I think the team was nearly already assembled. So it was just a few more people to fill it out, because I think the likes of yourself, Osgood, the Farnham boys like Harry, Sean May, they were already there. So, so it was from there, a trial at Aldershot. I think I was only 19 at the time. So went through the trial. I remember Keith Baker on the day of the trial. And that was the only person I really picked out of the first team who was there at that time. So it was from there, after the trial, I said, yeah, give you a nod. And onwards and upwards.
That's where then obviously we started to get to know each other. Little did we know, I certainly didn't, but at that time, both then originally Tongham boys, your family was living in Tongham at that time. And we became quite close, had a few. I remember one of your early birthdays where I had to keep you away from the local booze. I don't know if you remember that story. I think we made out that we were going to Walton or something, but I can't remember. Was that your 21st or was it your 18th? It was a real young one.
It was the 21st, and you took me to watch your mate Stan on it, I think.
Oh, yeah.
No, it was Joe O'Shea. He was playing, and I think it was down at Walton's or somewhere. The Staines were playing at Walton's. You probably plied them with a few too many drinks during the day. And it was my 21st birthday, and all the team were there. It was really nice, actually, because the spirit was great at that, you know, back then. And I didn't actually realise how I fitted into it so well. Looking back on it now, to have everyone turn up on that, it was a bloody great night.
Yeah, I think as we've got older, well, I think we knew that it was something special at the time, but as you get older, that that year, I don't care. I want Aldershot to go back in the Football League. I want Aldershot to be a super fantastic club and maybe even kick on if that's possible. But that year was just so special. It was just fantastic. I mean, and what's your first thoughts? I mean, everyone talks about the Clapton game. You know, what about yourself? In the starting lineup and the day, and what's the whole sort of story at the beginning of that season?
I don't know. The obviously started left back, I think. Played the first, I don't know, maybe might have been 15, 20 games until Nunny started getting involved because he came in late on that first season. But the first game, you just didn't know how it was going to go. I think my memories are not so much of the first game. It's different games along the way.
Okay.
When you realise that, you know, you've got a decent squad together here, the momentum's growing, and we were getting wins under our belt. I was, one way or another, like say, I was involved left back all the way up until Nunny come. And then I was moved around, but I don't think I missed too many games along the way. No, I was involved.
So we're certainly one of the highest appearance holders anyway, which I think you should be really, really proud of. I mean, what were you? We obviously went up that year. We went up as champions. One of the memories, one of the many memories I have of you was you actually, when we beat Tame 2-1 to actually clinch the title. I think we won promotion at Tring, but we won the title at home to Tame. And it was a pass from you that went in the inside channel that I got on the end of and scored. And I always remember that as well. So it's just things like that. But that's my memory. What does stand out for you in that first season? Anything in particular? I don't mean to put you on the spot.
Games like, I mean, there was Petersfield was in the league then. And I remember scoring at home vividly. And that was must have been very early on because I was still playing left back. I remember going up, it was sort of a long run up the left. And I've just hit it with my left foot, I think, as well. And the swinger. And it's ended up going in. I remember my mates being behind the goal. I was just sort of, that stands really poignant. I think we had Tring or Tame. I think it was the first season. It was home on Tuesday night and it snowed. I don't know if you remember that one, but that was a real good game. And there was like the Hampshire Cup games with Farnborough and that as well. It was the big days when we had lots of people. So I don't know if that was so much in the first season. But it would have been, I think we would have had.
I think it was the first one.
Yeah, so they were big days.
The newspaper said the fans would turn up for a game of Subutio and they were writing us off big time against Farnborough, weren't they?
Yeah, I think we lost out most of the time, but we give them our games every time. Yeah. And we held our own. But then there was the Colliers Row away. That was, I think, the first away game. I think that stays in the mind a little bit more than the first home game. Probably for the coach trip there and the rollicking that Harry got off the manager.
I remember it only too well for having a game of cards.
After that, I was never a card player, but they didn't go down too well, did it?
Well, I had a great day because I got a goal that day and also nicked a load of money off at Harry, to be honest with you.
Well, he had a bad first half, wasn't it?
He did. For those listeners, we'll get him on, but Steve Harris was having a bit of a nightmare and the gaffer had a go at him. And he actually owned up, didn't he, Stu? He actually said, well, I'm thinking about the cards. I can't believe he said it at half-time.
About the money I lost, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's it. We could believe it.
We turned it around, didn't we? We won 2-1. I think it was 2-1, wasn't it?
So, yeah, it was 2-1. It was 2-1. What about Wigs and the crowd? I mean, was it anything that you were expecting? I know we were all hoping that the crowd was going to turn up, but what was your views on Steve Wignall and the fact that towards the end of that season, you know, we're getting 3,000 and 6,000 turned up at Farnborough? I mean, it was unique, wasn't it?
Yeah, I was lucky. I fed off the crowd in the sense of I'd get slated at times for being a bit, should we say, agricultural. But, you know, and that would feed off me and I had a sort of a resilience that would just want to do better. So my job was pretty simple. I, you know, head tackled and kicked people. But Yeah, the crowd was brilliant. You know, you when you actually get into the game, I think you're lost. You don't actually notice it, but there are little snippets within the game where you do pick up on it, and it does give you that extra edge. There's just a whole build up to it beforehand. They're getting ready for a game. The weeks were Tuesday, Saturday. I had a job, and I was lucky enough that it was a physical job, so I never had to train, you know, and I'd done my training at work, and even though we did train as well.
Yeah.
But I was, the fitness side of it was what I thrived on, and I didn't actually care about work. That's what the point I was getting to. I just thought about football, and the focus all day long. I mean, I work with Jamie Orton and people like that, so they're all thinking about football all day long. And that's the only conversation we had. And we did Tuesday to Saturday. And more often than not, we had games, didn't we? You know, so we were playing all the time.
Yeah. I mean, we got promotion that year. It goes without saying. We'll talk a little bit about a post-match tour that we were on. But that we're going to the next year. And we had two massive rivals with us then. And we brought, I think, the best out of those two clubs. I don't think they've ever been the same since, but we had Newbury and Chertsey in our league. I mean, they had some big players, Stu.
Yeah, well, Parry come to us, didn't he, from Newbury?
Yeah.
And then Chertsey, Chippy up front, didn't they? Was that the boy up front?
Yeah, well, they had Sansom and they had Gleeson at the back. They had Roger Joseph, Ricky Hill. I mean, they were, and if you remember, Newbury appointed Don Howe, who not long before been England and Arsenal's coach, and had half of Reading's reserve team for Newbury. Yeah. I mean, it was unheard of for the league. I think all three teams pretty much romped the league to get promotion the second year. But they would never have had them teams, in my opinion, if it wasn't for us being in that league.
I think the other clubs, it sort of made their season, didn't it? You know, we was lucky as players to be there and just fell into a time when it restarted. Because we wouldn't, I don't think we would have been, I don't know, playing for the first team if it was like sort of not, didn't fold. But just the opportunity that we had, it went down really well. Other clubs loved it. And the buzz, like sort of all around the league at the time, although it was lower leagues, but going up through them, it's a little bit like the Wimbledon experience. Although that was later than ours, they must have carried so many clubs with them.
Yeah, 100%. How did you find Wigs? I mean, personally, obviously it was well known that I think, you know, Steve Harris could take or leave Steve Wignall, which is a bit of a shame. But a lot of that was because of defenders. Now, I loved him personally. I'd run for a brick wall for the bloke. But you were a defender. Was he a bit harder on you guys at the back?
To this day, I don't know why Harry sort of didn't see eye to eye with him, but I got on really well with him. He was straight with me. And you do play for managers, no matter what anybody says. You can have 11 blokes play for one bloke and they're not going to do the same as they do for another. You've got to sort of trust what you're being told. You've got to want to play for that person who's managing the club. And I was more than happy with Wignall. So he was honest enough to say, you might not always be in the squad, but if I'm in charge, you'll always be here. So that was the sort of relationship I had with him.
Well, we've won promotion and we go away and we've had a couple of them. I can't remember which year it was, but I think it's safe to tell a couple of stories. I think it might be quite nice for the viewers just to sort of say, again, I think what the team spirit was like, because we had a post-match tour and a post-season tour, and nearly every player was there as well for that, weren't they?
Yeah, I think we had a few. It was we had Portugal, Malta, didn't we? I think we even
yeah.
done
that. Yeah.
But yeah, they were... And even the fans come on one of them, didn't they?
Yes, they did. If Mike Scott's listening in, and some of the originals all turned out. They found out where we were going. There was about, I think that was Malta. I think they found out there was about, I don't know, probably about 20 of them out there, weren't there?
It was handy for Burnsy. He got a drink, wasn't it?
Yeah. But a story I want to say, because it was me and you involved again. I mean, we... Now, the boss, Steve Wignall, he used to room with Keith Baker. And I want to let you take it up. I'll set you up. You can take it up. But now, Wiggs, we're out most of the night. Wiggs has gone off to bed early. For me, it's a schoolboy error. He's waiting for Keith Baker to come back, but he's left his door slightly ajar. And you and I are walking past it. Over to you.
Oh, it doesn't take much for us, does it? You know? And I think it started off the chain of events, what happened afterwards. So we've snuck in the bedroom a bit quiet. He's snoring away, and we've upended the mattress, haven't we? He's ended up on the floor. So quickly done a runner, because he was no mug either, was he? He'd definitely have a go, wouldn't he?
Yeah.
We better get out of the way. But that led to, I think it was a few days later, that they've gone out for a meal in the afternoon. They've ended up they'd planned to do our room. I think we'd sort of sussed something was going on, so we planned to do theirs, didn't we?
Yeah.
So I think the head's come off the toothbrush, the toothpaste got cut in half, the middle's out of the boxer shorts, the end's out of the socks. So all these silly games that you get up to when you're involved in football teams.
Yeah, well, we got back to our room and we found they'd gone for a meal and they'd had fish, or they either bought these fish heads. Now, you can imagine, again, the viewer at home, if it's red hot in either, I don't know if it's Portugal or Malta, might have been Portugal, this one. But in the middle of the beds, on the top, were these two fish heads left on plates. Stunk our room out massive. So they did get a little bit of payback there.
Yeah, I think that was Malta, because the first tour we had was Portugal on it, and it was all very, very serious. And we had a game out there, didn't we? Although it was on a bit of red grass, wasn't it? It was like on the training ground at the back of the club. We trained on the car park, didn't we, at the back of the club? So, which is now a proper car park, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, those fishes, the only thing with that, though, was when we had the fish heads, and now they're getting older and older and more rancid and rancid, those fish heads must have done about four or five rooms.
Yeah,
well, they were going round and round.
I don't think I stayed in our room after that. It stunk. So.
It did.
But yeah,
many good times we had, and we used to enjoy it. We used to play hard on the pitch, and then play hard off of it. And I don't mean hard as in rough tumble, although you could handle yourself, no doubt about that. But what I mean is we didn't mind a drink, but we were always ready for the game the next day.
Yeah, I think the level of sort of commitment that got put in for where we were, and it's the only way we were going to get any results, you know. Everyone did take it really seriously. Everyone put it in, trained as hard as they could, and got to sort of as fit as you could, being expected for where we were, actually, because we could hold our own with anybody in the Premier, even when we were playing the cup games and everything. I remember like days like Hendon away and that.
Yes.
There. You know, we held our own with them, and they were a good side at the time. One of the sort of disappointing things, Kingstonian, at home. So when we were in the cup game,
We went one up as well, I think, didn't we?
Andy Russell scored, didn't he?
Yes, that's it. It
must have been about 5 or 10 minutes from the end. And when they disallowed the goal, that just I think we run out of puff by then. I think it ended up being 3-1 in the end, didn't it, or something?
It might have even been four in the end. Jimmy Bolton kind of put us to the sword. It's a bit of a sad way to go. I didn't think we really deserved that. But you're right, we got through to that cup final where Premier teams were in it.
Imagine, in a perfect world, the grass would always stay green. The sun would always be shining. The birds would always be singing. And not one of us would be vitamin D deficient. For more information, please go to www.yourpersonalisedvitamins.co.uk.
Thornet Project Services Limited proudly supports Aldershot Town FC.
Are lions, and time is the land we roam. A land where we pounce on every occasion. Yes, time is our territory.
We had the right blend. I don't know whether Weeks got lucky or whether he was, you know, simply brilliant in putting us together. We had, you know, people like Keith Baker still had, you know, my opinion, at that time, it still had National League class. A smattering of us had played in the National League. And then we had some youngsters.
Yeah. People like Brian Lucas, remember? Brian at the beginning. Yeah. He still done jobs for us. I remember, was it Worthing away? I think it was a four-all game.
Yeah, it was.
And Lucas was brilliant.
Yeah, he was.
So, but then playing beside Keith Baker, like, for me, was brilliant. I mean, he was quality, absolute quality. But you look at the players that were in the squad and you go through, starting off in Div 3, like, you know, TC come into it, he's got quality in abundance. There was yourself who played higher. There was Osgood who come from higher clubs. Keith, obviously, a lot higher. Then you've got the mix of, like, Brian Lucas was the TC, like, sort of before TC, if you get me.
Yeah.
And he just had quality and he had a vision and an understanding of the game that not many of us have got. But just mixing with all of them players and feeling that you fitted in, because everyone did fit in, like you were like sort of saying there. Everyone had a place, and like under Wignall, and he only left because he had good opportunities to go to, like, Doncaster, wasn't it, in the end?
Colchester.
And he had Doncaster after that.
Yeah,
but yeah, because that was his hometown club as well, wasn't it? I think.
I think Donny was, but he'd played about. He'd made loads of appearances for Colchester. So when they've come in out of blooming, what a leap in terms of levels that was. There's no way he could turn it down. I wouldn't want him. I wouldn't have wanted to get in the way of anyone, even us players, if they could have had a leap like that.
Yeah, because even at the beginning though, it was meant to be Ian McDonald as the manager, wasn't it?
Yeah, and he went to Millwall, didn't he?
Yeah, so he went that way. And then Wiggs obviously was an ex-player and he was the next one for the call.
But let's go on now to... there's a couple of things I want to talk about, really. But Steve Wignall leaves. Steve Wigley takes over. What's your first impressions of the second Wiggs? And eventually, I think Wiggs, and correct me if I'm wrong, was it Wiggs who you eventually ended up leaving the club when Wiggs was in charge?
Yeah. When Wigley took over, my relationship with him at first was okay. He was playing for Bognor. And I think I'd kicked him silly a couple of weeks beforehand. So he was well aware of me. And he sort of knew what a what I was about. So, and in saying that, and you'll know better than most, but I used to tackle people hard, and I used to come through people hard, and I used to head it hard, but I wasn't malicious in what I'd done. I made sure there was the ball somewhere between what I did. And you know, in all the time that I was at Aldershot, I never got sent off once.
Well, I was going to say that, and I will come back to your story in a second, but whilst you've brought it up, your disciplinary record for Aldershot was fantastic. Now, I know you're a tough lad from knowing you outside football as well as in football, but I have to agree wholeheartedly. It's actually written down here that for this big, tough defender, I mean, I got sent off three times. You didn't get sent off once.
Sorry for your larrup, though.
Yeah, it was. It was nothing for rowing. It would have been through lumps like you kicking me.
I never felt a need to speak to a referee or like have a go at, if someone had like sort of upset me on a pitch, there'd be time for them a little bit later on. So I never needed to do it. And I didn't feel I needed to do it maliciously either when you've got enough presence to do it when the ball's there. So, but that was me. I mean, even the count of bookings, you don't want to sort of jeopardise yourself in the sense that you want to play as well. So everything, you're aware of all of them sort of things. And to get reckless on a pitch, I had a lot of time to think while I was on a pitch in the sense that you guys were doing most of the work up the front. But you just had to be switched on all the time. And I could focus that way. And I had discipline, even though, you know, it come with a bit of force.
Brilliant. But, you were saying though about Wiggs.
Yeah, going back to Wiggly. So he knew what I could do. He was quite happy with me at first. I was quite happy enough with him. I think, and if he's listening, he's listening, but it felt to me that he wanted to be involved. He wanted to be involved, and a focus was a little bit on what he could do during the week, like in training, not what we could do. And it wasn't so much setting up a side to play and have some structure on what was doing at the weekend. It was just him enjoying himself on a training night. And that there was a lack of, if I could say, if I had the basis don't manage it, Ernie Howe. Yep. If I had him coaching me, I'd have gone further.
Okay.
And they did come in for me when we were playing. Harry had gone. Yep. I think we were at Newport in the FA Cup game when we won 3-1. And that was the only time then, because it was like a handshake with me and Wignall about how we were, like sort of as sort of a relationship. It's sort of, I've never signed a contract, you know, and that was him wanting to sign me on a contract then, because Basingstoke come in for us. But if I'd have not stayed with, I couldn't leave Aldershot, but if I'd have not stayed with Wiggly as it progressed, I'd have done better as a player, because I think I'd have had more respect for Ernie Howe, someone like that, who wanted to coach defenders. Wiggly just wanted to, well, he'd lost control of a lot of things by the time that he finished. I think I got a contract sent through when we finished the 97 season. So contract come through to me, and I looked at it and I left it on the table. So I never signed it. By the time pre-season come round, I thought, right, better grow up about this and speak to him and sort something out. So I went and saw him, gave him a call, went and see him. And he said to me, Stuart, I can't control you anymore. He said, but Avant will phone you tomorrow with a deal on the table. So that was that. And then I signed for Avant. Like I went and saw, I forget his name now. But I should remember his name. It's a big centre half. He used to play down there.
Liam Daish, no?
No, it wasn't Liam. Liam come after. It was, I'll think of it in a bit and let you know.
Yeah, no worries.
But anyway, they phoned me up the next day, true to his word, phoned me up, come and saw me, signed a deal there. They wanted to sign me on a 2-year. I'd only sign a 1 because I'd like sort of never really sort of been anywhere else other than local. And then 6 days later, Wigley went to Forest. So he'd already lined himself up with a job and thought he'd help his mate out by firing me to them. So that was my ending. So, but the, I brought my own downfall really because I was pretty headstrong. I think I probably let myself down and let the club down in the last few games of that season because I had the ump with him. And yeah.
There was something you just said then, though. He said he couldn't control you. I don't really remember you being out of control at all. Did you? Do you remember sort of playing him up a little bit then or not?
I suppose it was near the end. It was like sort of... I suppose there was a lot of things going on. A lot of things had gone on in my time there, I suppose, when you look back at it. But, yeah, I just... I think physically, sort of my input... in potentially putting other people into the team, and was I ready to come on when I needed to come on, or start when I needed to start? I think I sort of let myself down just the last few games.
Right. Okay.
Like I can say not Maidstone, Maidenhead away. That was the biggest downfall of mine.
Okay. I don't particularly remember anything that stands out. I don't want to.
I think we got stuff 3-1 by them. But, yeah, I think I've been out a bit too long the night before.
Okay. If this meeting does finish a bit premature, Stu, we'll try and just set up another one just to finish it off because they're only on, like, 40 minutes. But we'll edit that bit. So you move on. I actually catch up with you a little bit after having them. You have a little bit of time with me at Staines. And then I can't remember, but you left Staines and went, did you go back to having?
No. No, I've done my time at Avant. Again, it was just like not a very strong manager who was down there, and I didn't have a lot of respect for him. Yeah. I had more respect for the assistant, who actually ended up taking over. And when I done my time there, it went. That's when Avant and Waterlooville merged. But okay. If I'd have signed my 2, I'd have been in the first year of sort of Avant and Waterlooville. But I think I just said I've had enough. I didn't even bother going and picking up my pay packet and just I never went back. That was getting close to the end of the season. So that was the end of that one. So I think that was what might have, I don't know if I'll give you a phone call and see what's happening next year. And you said you was at Staines, and I think I popped over there and met Basher and that. And we had a bit of fun there for a while.
Yeah, we did. But I want to move on now, because obviously playing finishes, we both had a little spell in management, and you were very successful. And I just think, I bet the viewer doesn't know, that's all. I mean, you had a great time down at Ash.
Yeah, I don't know about very successful. I turned around a team that was like 13th. I got roped in there because TC was down there for a while. Choppers was down there. So I think I went from Avant to Staines to not playing for a bit, for a little bit, then played for Egham and done a couple of seasons down there. And then I just jacked it all in. I wasn't playing for enjoyment. I was getting a little bit of pocket money then, and I was playing for the pocket money. So I just thought, this ain't me. So, yeah, that stopped it all. And it was TC getting me back involved. So I think I went down there and played a little bit underneath him. But TC, I think, was a bit wild at the time. So him controlling himself was quite hard. I think it was short-lived for him. And then we had, I think, Terry Eames come in and manage down there. I think if I've got it right, from ex-Wimbledon. So he was managing, but he just didn't have a clue. He didn't know what the lads were about locally. He didn't have the dressing room, so he was short lived. And I thought, what do I do here? Like, so I ended up. I don't really think I was helping out. I think I was actually playing. And then I just went from player to player manager down there. And then sort of, when I did get managing, I tried to get myself out of the team, but local football, people letting you down or whatever, and just trying to fill in roles, then I did play quite a bit as well.
Brilliant.
And very enjoyable. We come second. I think we come second and we come third. We got the semi-final of Cup, but I didn't actually get any silverware down there, which is another one of my regrets. Not getting any silverware at Aldershot, other than that I sort of winning medals for the league, and that's a bit of another one that I think should have got better, should have got further in the Atherton game, in the Vars.
Yeah.
So we all know about that one, don't we? And disappointments there.
Yeah, definitely.
So I think when we got the flip of the coin to come back home, we thought we had it in a bag, and maybe if it was the other way around, I think it would have been a different result.
I agree, and I thought we played well up there. That was the game out of all of them. I thought that was the game we should have or deserved to win, actually. The 0-0 back up at their place, but it wasn't to be. I just want to touch on a couple of little things. I love your backdrop, Stu. So you've got a nice little bar going on there.
Yeah, it's got to be done. I think it was my daughter who made me do that. So that's showing my age now, because she's 18. That's the youngest one. So, so it was all a bit of a project over lockdown. I mean, I've been working all the way through. But I've had to try and do something to keep them occupied.
Brilliant. We are running out of time, but I just want to try and touch on the story, Stuart. We all went back, didn't we? A bit of class of 1992. Calvert, TC, he was the big joker in the team, but we all went out in the middle of the pitch, didn't we? You can tell him just finish off. We've got a couple of minutes, Stuart. You might have to rush it, but tell everyone the story. I know we're out there and we're telling Tony, aren't we, to go out in the middle. He's got a wave to the crowd.
Yeah, I've got the video of it still.
Have you?
And also, my nephew was in the East Bank and he clocked it very early and he videoed it. So I've got a copy of that as well.
So, if you get one, if you can get it to us, it'd be great. We'll put it on here.
Yeah. So, but yeah, TC, he done me up a couple of times. He done my boxer shorts. You know, we all know the deep eating his teeth one from Stairsy and stuff like that. There was lots of little different things that he used to do. But he'd regularly cut your boxer shorts, and I think something got caught when I put my trousers on without my boxer shorts. I owed him one or two over the duration. So I said to Tony, we'd just come out, they've introduced myself, they've introduced a couple of others, and there were still stairs in and some others to come out. But I said, Tony, they want us over the other side. And I clocked the sprinklers are on. So, if you see the video, you can see he didn't trust me to take my hand, because obviously blind at the minute. So I've said, no, Tony, we've got to go to the other side. So I've walked him over the other side and straight through the sprinklers. And it wasn't very nice of me, but it was, we had a giggle about it. Tony would have done it to me if it was the other way around. And I do feel it's naughty, but I don't have any regrets about it. I do. When my nephew, he said that I saw it and I videoed it, and he sent me it. So, it's one for the memory bank, that, definitely.
Tone. Can't help Tone get out there. Are you taking the pictures there?
I'm just doing the video.
It's not a good advert.
Is it? That's as quick as he went when he played.
Straight
in the box.
Was on the pitch with you, mate, and it made me laugh, and you could see what was coming. Obviously, Tony couldn't. Stu, our time is now. I've got less than a minute on this call. Listen, personally, we need to catch up a lot more, but I hope our little, you know, half-hour spell is good for you fans at home at Aldershot, and I just want to thank you very much, just in an official capacity, but also as a mate. It's good catching up with you.
I'd say the fans as well, like sort of, I remember the South Bank, wasn't it? You know, underneath that after the games. So that bar ain't there no more, is it?
Well, not in the way it was with us. Not in the way it was with us. If it leaves, yeah. Stu, if it leaves, I just want to say thank you, but we will carry on. But I'm just saying, if it does go out, and it's because it's saying I've got less than a minute. So we had lots of memories there, mate. And I thank you for catching up with us. But we must catch up soon personally when we can.
Oh, well, there's always a space around there you can fit in here, mate.
Just imagine, in a perfect world, the grass would always stay green, the sun would always be shining, the birds would always be singing, and not one of us would be vitamin D deficient. For more information, please go to www.yourpersonalisedvitamins.co.uk.
Thornet Project Services Limited proudly supports Aldershot Town FC.
I hope you enjoyed the interview with Stuart. I really enjoyed making it with him. I haven't spoken to him for a long time. We are friends, and it's funny, we took a phone call after that interview, and we came up with even more stories that we could have thought about during the interview, but maybe there for another time. But it was really good fun catching up with an old teammate of mine. It's time now for the Crimea-sponsored Around the World. Over to Matt and Henry. I'm not sure where they're taking us this time.
Beckenbauer. Manuel Neuer. Bastian Schweinsteiger.
Podolski.
Gerd Müller.
Nisa, Vulture, Ferrer, Weir, Natcher, Deutschland. This week, we're off to Germany, specifically Berlin.
Good afternoon. We are joined by the Order Shop Crazy Ones in Berlin. How are you all?
Thank you, very fine.
And tell us a bit more about the Order Shop Crazy Ones and what's that like for you guys in Germany?
What, like on an Aldershot? What do you like on Aldershot?
Tell us about Aldershot and the Crazy Ones and the sort of the group you have over there.
Okay, we are the Crazy Ones. And 2 years ago, we were in London, and in Aldershot, we go every year to England and saw matches in the fourth division, what we see, League Two, League One, Championship or Premier League. But in 2019, we go the first time to Aldershot. Aldershot against Ebbsfleet, I think it was Aldershot Ebbsfleet. It was a 1-1, I think. And it was a very fine atmosphere for the fifth division. German is fifth division is 100 clubs. And in England, it's the fifth division, 24 clubs. It's for, and it's professional. In German, it's the fifth division is not professional, or half professional, or nothing professional. And the atmosphere in Aldershot was very fine. We saw the game, we drank beer, we eat, and after the match, we go to in the pub. I don't know the name of the pub near the stadium. What's the name of the pub?
The Crimea pub.
Lions pub or
Crimea pub.
We go in the pub and was a good party with live music and it was very fine. And one day later we go to Southampton against Tottenham. We go to the Premier League game. It was not so good as in Aldershot. And as at this moment we are Aldershot Crazy One in January 2019.
And that's just like you say, it's the sort of atmosphere you get here with Aldershot. It's, you know, it's there's nothing quite like it, is it? It's so enticing and so exciting for you guys coming over to England and seeing the games.
In Aldershot, in fifth division, 2,000 spectators. In the fifth, in Germany, 100. In the fifth division, professional. And the fans are very, the atmosphere was better as in a Premier League game. Was very fine.
And looking at you guys as well, you've got your own crazy ones logo as well on your t-shirts. I could see them with you guys over there.
Okay. it was an idea from this guys. It was.
And it was how many members of the Crazy Ones are there?
I think seven members. Seven members. We four come from Berlin, and the other five guys come from Berlin and two guys from south of Germany and the other two guys are near Stuttgart. We are seven members.
And it's a public, not so public,
but not so known in Germany. Aldershot is not
so well known.
Not known in Germany.
Yes.
But we are, I think we are the only seven, we are only the seven fans from Aldershot in Germany, in the whole of Germany.
And do you have any particular memorable moments watching Aldershot Town?
Particular moments in Aldershot?
But any of your favourites?
Particular, please?
Your favourites or anything like that?
The best moments in Aldershot?
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, best moments in Aldershot. best moments in
and the Mr. President from Aldershot.
It was a very great moment for us in the traditional cabinet of Aldershot, town. Aldershot is a military town, and in the traditional cabinet, is this the right word? Traditional cabinet in the traditional room was a membrane from the hundreds. One moment.
No worries. Yeah. Da war eine Ausbildung.
Von der 100th anniversary from First World War One in 1914, English soldiers and German soldiers play football on the front in 1914. And a new traditional cabinet was in 2014, 100 years later, was our defense minister and the defense minister of Great Britain
Ja, deine Sendezeit ist gleich rum.
Ja, du bist doof, George. And 100 years later, celebrate the anniversary in 2014. It was a great moment for us, German soldiers and English-British soldiers, 100 years before we were in Aldershot. And this was a great moment for us and for me. Was very good.
For you guys, it's more than just the football and the football club. It's the Aldershot area and the whole town and everything.
Aldershot area. Aldershot is not the nicest town in in Great Britain. But we come from Berlin. We come from the southeast of Berlin, and this is an industrial area 100 years ago. And now you have the buildings, and in the buildings are painters or art artists and so on, and a little bit in this, but it's the same atmosphere a little bit.
You know, I've never been to Berlin or Germany, so hearing you talk about Germany and Berlin is interesting to me because I've never been, so I'd love to go and visit someday.
But you have never been in Germany?
No.
In Berlin, the Union Berlin. No tickets.
when everything changes and we're allowed to, I'm sure I'll try and come over at some point. As well.
It's an invitation for you and for Mark. You come to Berlin, but when spectators half a year next season allowed, what is allowed?
Allowed.
That was right. Yeah, I think that's where we understood.
Allowed when spectators allowed in September or in end of this year or in 2022.
And we'll have some German beer.
German beer. That is more alcohol. In German beer is 1-2% more alcohol as in British beer.
In British beer,
3.5. German 5.5. But in the Union Berlin is every game overcrowded. 22,000 spectators is a small stadium, and Union Berlin have 37,000 members. 37,000. Union Berlin is the greatest club, the greatest sports club in Berlin. More than Hertha Berlin. Hertha Berlin has Olympic Stadium. Olympic Stadium have 80,000 spectators, and Union Berlin have only now in 2021, only 22,000 spectators. In 5 years, 3 years, 37,000 spectators. It was the stadium was bigger than now.
And how are Union? And how are Union Berlin doing this season?
Oh, seventh place. A very good season without spectators. Without spectators against Bayern Munich 1-1, against Borussia Dortmund 1-2. What clubs you know? Bayer Leverkusen, you know, yeah. Bayer Leverkusen. Yeah. Union 1-0, 1-0. Yes. It was a very the best season as in the history of Union Berlin. The best season now without spectators. And we're looking forward, and we're glad when we go to Aldershot in half a year. That was a great moment for us in 2022. January or February, we come to Aldershot.
Yeah. We look forward to seeing you.
Yes, and we look forward. But for us is we have one problem at Union Berlin. One problem is every game is overcrowded. We have season tickets, and we must go, to buy tickets for you. It is very difficult for us.
That is very nice.
We get it. It's this invitation for you, and we are glad to see you.
And you, we're so glad to see you, and hopefully we can see you in real life soon when things are better.
Real life soon, yes. But it's a pity my English is not so good. I speak not everyday English. I must go to the school.
No, your English is much better than my German, so it's no problem. Okay. But no, it's great to talk to you about Aldershot Town and the football club and the area and everything. Like you say, it's particularly this area, some of the most passionate fans in the league as well. And like you say, it's probably the same in Berlin as well. They're so passionate and excited, the fans.
Yes, passionate. The Aldershot fans is a team in the fifth division with so many fans. 2,000 or 3,000, 4,000, I think, is fascinated for the fifth division. In Germany, we have a nationwide third division as a nationwide league one, a nationwide, and the first division have five tables. In the first division, not one table, but five tables, and the fifth division, 10 tables, 12 tables, I think, and they have no fans in the fifth division. But in England, it's fascinated. Little clubs, so nice atmosphere. Little club as Aldershot Town, so nice atmosphere. Two and a half thousand spectators, and after the game, we go to the pub, and the boss is very nice. Boss, very good.
Always nice.
And you follow our results as well.
Yeah, it's the next game in Notts County in Nottingham, I think, at Saturday. And last was 3-0 against Wrexham.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah,
3-0 against Wrexham. So, every Saturday we're looking.
We had the game against Wrexham, and then we played Maidenhead away, and we beat them 4-2. And then we had the FA Trophy game, which we unfortunately lost on penalties.
Yes.
So very similar.
Very similar. We have an app, a looking. Kicker is a German football newspaper, two times a week, and have an app. International football, National League, England, National League, next game. Aldershot Eastleigh was not against Aldershot against Eastleigh was last Saturday, and the next game Aldershot in Nottingham, Notts County. I think that's every Saturday we're looking.
Fantastic.
Have you got any players from this season that you know of? Any players that you're a favourite, so that you know of?
No, it's only the shooters. When we go a little.
A bit simpler,
I'm sure you like all of them, of course.
it's only a little match report. A little match report with.
With the scorer.
I know only the scorer from Wrexham. When I'm looking here, the scorer from Wrexham was. Georgi, wann der letzte Spiel der 23.2. war, glaube ich, war. Aldershot gegen.
Notts County ist der nächste, genau.
Notts County, der Torschütze, er will wissen, ob wir Spieler kennen. Ja?
No.
Matt und Mark.
We know. Joel Noble and Jermaine Anderson.
Yes,
Anderson and Joel Noble, two scorers against Wrexham, and German Anderson in the 68 minutes, 3-0.
Yes, very good players.
But both players are good.
Well, thank you very much for all your time, the Aldershot Crazy Ones. We look forward to seeing you soon, having a beer together, watching some football. Thank you so much for all your support and everything you do for us.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
All love, Short.
Have a nice evening.
So Germany, it was the Aldershot Crazy Ones. Quite apt that the Crimea sponsor the Around the World scene, because the Germans have been to the Crimea pub, which of course opens soon, and they've also been in the lounge a couple of times. They've become firm friends. And when we sent an email out about In With A Shot recently, they had no hesitation on joining the In With A Shot scheme as a collective, and also making a donation of €350 to this football club. So thank you so much, All Shot Crazy Ones. I can't wait to see you all next season, because I know you're coming over. But that's quite apt about talking with In With A Shot, because it's now time for that section of the show. You know the colourful character that is Mike Busey. He is going to be drawing out two new winners.
There, I've been thinking there's all kinds of ways to support our club, and our club needs it, like everyone in a similar position. And one of the ways, of course, is In With A Shot. And if you're not signed up, then I hope that you'll think about it. When you know that by this means, since we started In With A Shot, we have presented to the club £11,047. Well, I reckon that must be rather useful to those up there. So we could do even better. Right, there are other people, of course, who serve this club. The volunteers. Nah, we've got a load of volunteers. Match days every day. I often see a team of volunteers on a Friday when I go into the club. And I know that some of them have got number in the bag, and I really would like to pull out a number for one of our volunteers, but of course it's not within my power to do that. So let's get on with it. This is the £5 draw to tell you that the winner this morning, this evening, is number 4. Number 4 winner is
Joel Pusey.
Joel Pusey. Well done, Joel, whoever you are. That is very good for you, because coming your way, Joel, is £190. Well, we better hurry on and now do the £2 draw, for which, that's something, isn't it, eh? Crumbs alive. We knew it could happen, but I can assure you that my son and my grandson, they are good supporters of our club. I brought Andy here when he was 5. He's now 58. So he's been a Shot supporter for a long time, and he shows it in a number of ways, like being a part of this. And now for the £2 draw. The £2 draw is, the winner today is number 50. And number 50 is...
Tim Cowden.
Tim Cowden. Right, so Tim, you've got coming your way £157. So the club received today £347. We're going up, and we could go up further. So if you're not a part of In With A Shot, then get in touch with our commercial manager, Mark Butler. Just remains for me to say, have a good Easter weekend, and don't forget what it's really all about. God bless you.
Just imagine, in a perfect world, the grass would always stay green. The sun would always be shining. The birds would always be singing. And not one of us would be vitamin D deficient. For more information, please go to www.yourpersonalisedvitamins.co.uk.
Thornet Project Services Limited proudly supports Aldershot Town FC.
Are lions, and time is the land we roam. A land where we pounce on every occasion. Yes, time is our territory.
I hope you were the lucky winners. That actually brings the scheme up to nearly, I'm sure Mike told you, so I'm sorry for repeating it, but probably now nearly £11,000 in just 62 weeks, just over a year, raised for the club. But here's the important bit. Over £12,000 paid to you guys in winnings. It really is a win-win, and we must keep pushing it. It's dropping off a little bit. We keep increasing each week, but please encourage friends and family to join. It's a win-win. I want you to win and not donate your winnings back to the club, unless you really want to. But we actually want you to win, and we get money. And it is a massive task, but I do want to get 1,000 people in it. And imagine that. £52,000 to the club in the £2 scheme and £52,000 given to you. It's not impossible with our supporter base. So thank you to Oasis Electrical, who sponsor the In With The Shot scheme. But it's now time to go to a quiz. Now, we did a quiz. It was more about being interactive, more about being inclusive, more about connecting to our fans. So we arranged a quiz, hoping to get around 100 people. We got about 60. Nearly all of the first team were attending, as with the management and staff. It was great fun doing it online, and fastest finger wins. Here's a little editorial about how the quiz went. If you enjoyed it, we are planning to do another one. So when you look out for it, sign up.
Welcome. Read the slides, if you could, and just get your smartphone onto ahaslides.com/shots quiz. And we are then ready to go. I'd like to introduce you, though, to Howard Taylor and Ed Taylor of Howard Taylor Associates. Now, they look after financial arrangements and mortgages. They've done mine for many, many years. They've become good friends of mine. They've put this whole quiz together for us today, researched the questions with all of the answers. So I'd like to just put on record a thank you to them.
Who scored Aldershot Town's first goal of the 2021 season? You now pick the four candidates, pick the one you think is correct. It will tell you whether you got it or correct. 5 seconds left. And the majority of you there has got it right. It was Craig Tanner with apparently it was a very delicate chip, so I'm told. This one's a picture question, guys. So you've now got a little bit more time. Lewis Kinsella. If you add up his season squad number with that of Alfie Whittingham, when he was on the quiz, what number would Jack give you? Notice the Jack Grealish photograph in the background with Lewis, who's friends of him, but he doesn't like to talk about it, apparently.
squad numbers of them both.
Add the two squad numbers together. What number do you get? Oh, that caught a few more of you out. Yeah, absolutely. Now should be a little mini leaderboard.
Wow. And I'll just step in here. Howard, Gary Walford is leading. Our Camberley Printers man, Steve Francis, our kit man, is second. That was really good. Who's the top player there? Is it and Mitch? Josh Reese in fifth place, actually. Ryan Alien in completes the top three. Perhaps we can have a quick look, Ed, at the bottom. Not meaning to... Ian, I'm disappointed in you, Ian. You're a very, very Shots fan. And Tim, come on.
Plenty of time to catch up, guys. Plenty of time.
Plenty of time. There is plenty of time.
Okay, on to the next question.
I can't seem to... How do you answer questions?
No wonder you're not doing very well, then.
No, I keep clicking on the screen, but Ricky,
you need to get on your mobile phone.
Oh, I am on my mobile phone.
Harslides.com, Shots Quiz.
Oh, I need another mobile phone.
You do, because then that will tell you.
That would explain it then. Okay, well, you crack on there, and I'll just write it on paper.
No problems.
Who are the Shots opponents on Saturday the 5th of December when fans were allowed back in to see live football for the first time in 10 months? Was it Maidenhead United, Notts County, Dagenham and Redbridge, or was it Halifax Town? Oh, I think that's the biggest one of all. Most people got that one right. They were obviously looking forward to seeing the game. A former Aldershot player scored for the opponents that day as well. Dean Rance scored a late consolation for Dagenham. Last question in this round. It's a picture round again, so no bonus for doing it quicker. How many goals in all competitions did the Shots score against Woking in the 2021 season? Was it 3, 4, 5, or 6? That's a picture of a celebration in front of the Woking supporters, I think, there as well.
Wonderful.
Yes, it was 5. A 2-1 home defeat in the FA Cup, followed by a 3-0 win and a 1-0 win away from home. So that concludes the first round. You will now find the leaderboard.
And it's changed. Chris Heath, just ahead of Gary Woodford, who stayed in the top three, as did Ryan Alien. Well done. Steve Francis is heading down, as we fully expect. Sorry, Franny. Rob Worrell is crept up, and Josh Reese is the top player in sixth. Well done. I don't know if we need to look at the bottom. Perhaps it's not wise, but you can do. There's Danny Sell, about 12th. Sam O'Sullivan. So if you can tick your name coming up. Alfie Whittenham, you can see him there. And that's the end of round one.
So this is still Aldershot Town FC, but this is the history of the club in previous seasons gone by. The first question is a picture question again. So again, no bonus for faster answer. So take your time to get this one right. In June 2008, which club played the Shots reported 130,000 for Joel Grant, the record sale for Aldershot at that time? Was it Crewe, Exeter, Wickham, or was it Yeovil? And the answer was Crewe Alexandra. Incidentally, Joel Grant played in the championship.
Yes, he is. There you go. And Noobs, look, Noobs is 53. He won our mastermind. So he's struggling. He's got to pick it up a little bit. No, I didn't play with Chris, but I was at the club working when Chris was there. Wonderful man, of course, who we sadly lost. And if anyone is having troubles at home, hopefully things like this are helping you. And, of course, you can visit Mind. A few places. Don't be ashamed of reaching out. Chris, of course, we lost, who committed suicide, but wonderful player for us, and he won the Player of the Year 2 years running. End of round two. Chris Heath, still nudging ahead from Gary Woodford. Steve Francis, that's got to be an alias. I'm not having it. Reece Emerson's crept up into fourth, and Sam O'Sullivan. So you can see the different categories coming to fruition. Aaron and Craig have come on the board. Ollie and Graham, welcome. They're up there. And your dark horse, Connor, I won't go through them all. As Ed scrolls down, pick your name out. And you can see yourself in there. The Melbourne Reds, 16th. Mike Scott still going in there, 19th. The boss is falling down to the 21st. Unlucky boss. What's going on?
I'm a bit worried about the I Love Josh Reese entry. What's all that about? I want to know.
Yeah, I don't know. I have no idea. So
that is Josh.
Not a question for Danny, but it's a question for Noobs. I think he's in the call somewhere. Noobs, can you unmute yourself?
Yes. Yes, I'm here.
Craig has asked the correct pronunciation of your surname, please. So for everyone listening, could you give us the correct pronunciation of your surname, please?
Okay, so my surname is Noob. Everyone says Nooble. I prefer Nooble because I got a bit of flavour in my name. So, draw Nooble, if anybody asking.
Next one, and it's for Danny, which I think you might be able to see in the chat, Danny. If we could sign one player from the Premier League, who would it be? And Anwar, as he sent the message, we'll try and get in touch.
Oh, wow. Kevin De Bruyne. There you go. Good luck with that one, Anwar. I'm not sure. I'm pretty sure we won't be able to afford his laces, let alone his salary, but we can have a go.
Alfie Whittingham has just asked, who is the worst trainer?
Who's not on the call? Who's the worst trainer? Wow. If you ask the lads, they would probably say Mo. Sorry, Mo. If you're asking me, I'd say Alfie Whittingham.
Right, another one for you, Danny. Who is the best player you have coached, other than the ones we've got here, obviously?
Probably either Callum Hudson-Odoi or Declan Rice. We would obviously prefer our players to train on grass if we had the facilities to do that, but unfortunately we don't. So we have to just deal with what we've got to deal with. And the lads, to be fair to them, they just get on with it. So we're quite fortunate in that way. Best manager to have a drink with after a game. Well, this season it's been great because we haven't been able to have a drink with any of them because of COVID. So I don't know, Anne. Who would you say? To be fair, last season we didn't really have any coming, did we? Darren Curry, wasn't it?
He came in. Ben Strebbins is always good. Sometimes when we go to grounds, I wouldn't say not nice to us, but you know when you get offered a nice tea, maybe a biscuit. I am partial to a biscuit, but Eastleigh always look after us quite nicely. Ben Strebbins.
Yeah, Strebbins' quality, to be fair, top guy. I think, to be honest with you, we're probably one of the most hospitable places because when we go away, we have to take our own kettle. And we take our own tea bags and our own coffee and our own water and our own milk because there's a lot of clubs that don't actually look after you that well. And I know it's a tough thing with COVID at the minute, but yeah, no, Strebs is top draw. John Steele's always a good one. Obviously, he's close with Annie and he's got some great stories and whatnot. But actually, coming into the dressing room, it's not like it used to be because, to be fair, if we've lost away from home, I don't want to go and speak to their manager. And probably if we've won away from home, they probably don't want to speak to us either. So it's one of those.
Okay, I think we're going to start cracking on now with round three then. So round three is about England men's national team. Obviously, we've got a game tomorrow night against San Marino. Gutted I can't be there, but there you go. Such is life. But the first question has got an Aldershot twinge to it. But this is to test the people here that perhaps are very, very good at Aldershot that not perhaps so good at other stuff. So the winner of the quiz will be an all-rounder. So the first question in this round. How many players who have played for either Aldershot FC or Aldershot Town FC have also played for England's first team? This can be before or after. They could have played for England before joining Aldershot or afterwards. So is it 2, 3, 4, or 5? I thought that would catch a few of you out, actually. It's 5. So we've got Neil Webb, Chris Powell, Teddy Sheringham, Alex McCarthy, and Nick Pope.
Yeah, Reece Emerson, late addition to the quiz. has shot up. Only 3 points, though, ahead of Chris Heath. Those two going neck and neck. Aaron and Craig have been up to the top, but dropped back down to third. And Oliver and Graham Brookland have sneaked into the top four. Sam's hanging on in there, and so's Gary. Well done. You've been up there all the way, Gary. Keep going. Josh Reece, still the top player. And Ryan Alien still in the top 10. Steve Francis going down. Love that.
Sorry. And my dark horse, Connor Ward, has let me down. So round four is the previous incarnation of Aldershot before the current version of. First one's a picture question. Aldershot had Teddy Sheringham on loan from Millwall and were priced out of the permanent move for him. What was the reported asking price? £3,000, £5,000, £7,000 or £9,000? Safe to say, a bit of a mistake made there, I reckon.
Oh, I got this one right.
Good man. Yeah, in fact, the majority did. £5,000 for Sheringham.
Yeah, so this is the end of round four. Only one round to go. Chris Heath still top of the pile. Oliver and Graham coming into it now, though, in second. Have they left it too late for their charge? Sam O'Sullivan doing well. Aaron and Craig just dropping a little bit. Reece Emerson has had a bad couple of rounds. Gary Woodford still in the top 10. No, that's good. And then have a look at your name. Steve Francis dropping away. Love that. Mike Scott still in there, 17. And then come the players. Players I'd like to give a big thank you to anyway while they're listening. They've given up their time tonight. They probably haven't studied the history of Aldershot, in fairness to them. So I just want to thank them for joining in. Danny Searle dropping down, the boss, 36, mate. There we are.
Ray Hedgman, Crimea landlord down there somewhere. Last round, guys. These are quite easy, so get ready. Good points to be had if you get them all right.
Your chance to catch up now.
General sport. First one's darts. Who won the most recent PDC World Championships, with the final being played in early January 2021? Gary Anderson, Gerwin Price, James Wade, local boy, or Michael Van Gerwen? Yeah, Price, he beat Anderson in the final. Good knowledge, like boys. Who's the current world number one male snooker player? Judd Trump, Mark Selby, Neil Robertson, or the Rocket Ronnie O'Sullivan? Who's the current world number one? Everyone's gone in quick, butts. I reckon they need the points.
They've all gone early.
Yeah, the tension's really killing me. Oh, Judd Trump, Donald's brother. Managed to be the winner in that one. Got to the world number one in 2019. So now the big reveal, Buttsy. Big drum roll. Away you go, son.
Chris Heath has nicked it by 2 points.
Oh, my life.
Wowee. That is amazing. 2 points over Tim from Fleet. Reece Emerson comes in with third. Ollie and Graham with on fourth, and Jules fifth. But look at the top four, only 11 points separated four places when, like, a push of a button, if I'm honest.
When you think there's 2,000 points was the winning score, and yet there was only two between the top two. That's incredible, isn't it?
It is incredible. Have a look when you're going down. We need the top. We're not asking you to leave straight away. Have a little look at the scoreboard yourself. But we do need the top five. If they could just hang on and give us their details, I'd appreciate it. What I would like to say is a big thank you to Howard and Ed. They did put a lot of work in to making the quiz. I'd also like to thank the players. Can't be easy. You're giving up your evening, and especially if we've had a midweek defeat. So I'd like to thank them and the staff of the team that have come out and played. The questions, that's important. And I'd like to thank you all for playing. If we can unmute Danny, I think Danny would like to just say a quick thanks, Henry. Danny?
Yeah, guys, as Butts said, just to reiterate, we obviously, for two reasons really. One, because I think it's good for us to all get together and do something that's a little bit different than, trying to work out how many different new Netflix series we need to get through before we can actually get out of the house. But also, it's some valuable funds for the club. It's not been an easy year for us. And do you know what? Every little bit of support you've given us, whether it's through volunteering, donations, or even just being a supporter of the club, it's been fantastic and it's much appreciated. And I know myself, the staff and the players are can't wait to have you back at the stadium soon. And there is some light at the end of the tunnel. So fingers crossed. Yeah, so a massive thank you from us. Stay safe, keep well, and hopefully we'll see you all soon.
I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you're looking forward to maybe signing up next time. We could get a few more in, but it is about interaction. It was brilliant talking there to the players and the staff, and congratulations, of course, to the winners. The quiz was fantastically put together by Howard Taylor Associates. I'm very, very grateful to you for your time and effort. Brilliant, brilliant effort, and the questions were quite brilliant. The knowledge pool of Aldershot was truly fantastic. Coming up next, though, we've just got a little news item. Because there were no questions, I thought I'd fill you in with some facts and figures about what's going on around the club. With no questions this week, so we thought we'd bring you an update on what is coming up with the football club. Of course, some of these are all possibilities because of government restrictions, but we'll run through them. There is going to be a season ticket announcement soon from the football club. Final plans are in place about that. We have a golf day on the 22nd of July. That's at Putnam, and I only have about 5 teams left. So please get in touch with me if you'd like to play a nice round of golf. That is subject to us being able to have hospitality in the evening. But if you want to play, please get in touch with me. We're planning some kind of summer party on the 9th of July. We've got provisional booking at the Princess Hall, where we'll all have a great knees up. We've all been cooped up for so long. So let's see if we can get out. We have a nice meal from Clark's. Again, subject to being allowed to do these things. But I just want to tell you and give you as much notice about them as possible. We are planning to have hospitality in the last few games, or we're preparing to have hospitality in the last few games or last couple of games if we are allowed to have customers, and we're taking pre-bookings to try and get those lounges as full as possible within the restrictions that we're allowed. We think we might be allowed 40 odd in there. So if you want to attend hospitality at the end of the season, please get in touch with us now. Matt's asked me to mention to you the junior shirts deal. So junior shirts are £40 each, which would be £80 if you brought both the home and away. But if you buy them together at the moment, they are reduced to £65. So that's a big saving of £15. You can get both. I want to push three commercial parts, which are virtual mascots. They're great fun. You just get a Zoom call from your favourite player. Your child gets the kit. And you're on the TV show beforehand. So I want to just push the virtual mascots for the last few games. I've got three match sponsorships left, with a couple of those on a provisional. So I just want to get those finished and out of the way, and one ball sponsorship left for the remaining part of the season. Again, if you could email me on those and help the football club in any way, that would be great. Just talking about the streaming, we are planning to continue, if we're allowed, to do the live streaming of the games, even if we have a crowd back in for the last two. I think that at the moment that's going to be allowed, so we want you to come along as a crowd, but if there are some restrictions or some of you can't come, we are planning to continue the live streaming coverage of games. And please be aware that some of the things I've said are subject to what the government allow us to do. But we're trying to get pre-bookings in. So if there's anything that has taken your fancy, please contact us and get in. A couple of other things that I thought you might be wanting to hear. The streaming figures. On average, we're getting around about 800. And we topped off fantastically with Wrexham, where we had over 2,000. I have to say to you that an awful lot of those were Wrexham fans, so thank you to those. But we're getting around about 800. Our smallest ones are around about 450, where we get very few away fans. And one last interesting point for those gamers amongst us, esports. Now, esports is something that's quite new to me. This is in the gaming world where we've teamed up with a partner that's in Cambly, and we are launching competitions where you will get the opportunity to represent Aldershot in a FIFA competition. So basically, there's going to be an in-house competition to see who is the Aldershot champion, and then you may well go on to represent Aldershot in a football league, which will be playing all sorts of players that are representing their clubs as well. So if esports is your thing, or gaming is your thing, look out for a special Twitter page which is being set up by our PR team, and watch out for the launch of that in the media soon. I think that about wraps it up. Thank you for your patience. One last thing, next week is the big Q&A with the directors. So if you haven't got a question in, please get it into them now. You can ask any director any question. How it's going to work, there'll be an interview with me where I'll be asking them some questions as if I'm a fan. And if those questions are yours, then we won't ask it. But in the latter end of the show, we'll be asking the questions that you have sent in if they haven't already been asked. So I hope that little news bulletin fills you in. And up the Shots. Well, that about wraps it up for week 11. Thank you very, very much for viewing. Busy, busy week for us because, of course, tomorrow, this is being Thursday, tomorrow, Good Friday, we're at home to Stockport. It's the home tour of duty. Join in, sign up, just watch the game and get involved and feel part of the club, because that's what we need. We're missing you, and we want you to feel like we're still here and we need you. And that is actually very, very true. I can't wait to have you all back in the ground. Thank you for watching and tune in next week.